everybody. Welcome to Central. Let's all stand across this place as we begin to worship.
That you would all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who leaves his nation a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Lift that voice across this room.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, 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 yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Now you would take my place. Now you would bear my cross.
What a great way to start our time together. Thanks so much for singing with us. You may go ahead and be seated as we continue.
My name is Johnny, and I'm so excited to let you know that CYM Summer Camp is happening this summer. I had the opportunity to speak at CYM actually a couple weeks ago, and it's it's incredible what God is doing in the lives of youth here at Central. It's awesome. Every week, hundreds of students' lives are impacted by what's going on. And summer camp is just an extension of that. And if you have children from grades 5 to 8, then this is for them. And you don't want them to miss out on this experience. It's an opportunity for them to connect with God, discover Him, and to connect with other students their same age while having a ton of fun. And so registration is open. You can go out into the lobby. There's a big summer camps banner. It's bigger than my house. You can't miss it. And it'll be out there. You can register there. Grab some information. As well, you can register online at centralcc.ca/summercamp. If you are a first-time guest with us, we just want to extend a special welcome to you. We know it takes a lot of courage to come into a new place with new faces, maybe a new experience, and try something different. And we're really happy that you're here with us. We want to honor that. We actually just want to give you a gift. And so if you take the Connect card, it's in the back of the seat in front of you. You can actually just fill out that card and go to the blue wall out in the lobby after this experience, and you can exchange that card for a gift. It's actually just a $5 Timmy's gift card, which is pretty awesome because who doesn't love a large double-double and a Boston cream? I mean, right? Free, on the house. Had a little bit too many of those myself lately. Yes. And if you're online, you can actually just plug a USB drive into your computer and we will download the Boston cream directly to that. No, just kidding. But you can just click the new here button and we'd love to give you a gift as well. Right now, we are going to receive our morning offering. And if you are a guest with us, please feel absolutely no obligation to give. This is just simply something that we do as a church family, as an act of worship, as to reflect our generosity, because God, we believe that He has given us everything that we have, and this act of the offering is just a way to acknowledge that and to give Him back a portion of what He has given to us. And so we're going to do that right now, so let's just pray. God, I thank you so much for what you're doing here in Central and in this community and in the Niagara region. God, you have a vision and a plan for what's going on here. Behind the scenes, God, you are working and orchestrating something beautiful and something amazing that results with people's lives being transformed and redemption being seen, God. And we thank you for that. And so as we give our offering today, God, we pray that you would use it to make you famous in our lives and the lives of our friends and the family in the entire Niagara region. In Jesus' name, amen. There's a couple more things I want to let you know about. Coming up on April 24th at 6 p.m., we have our encounter service. Now, the encounter service is just a one-hour opportunity for you to just engage with God and to connect with God in a way that maybe you don't get the opportunity to do on a Sunday morning. The amazing band that you love every Sunday will be doing some songs, and it's just an opportunity for us to be unrushed and just have a time together in worship in that way. And also, coming up next Sunday, April 17th, we have our next opportunity for you to participate in baptism. Baptism Sunday is one of my favorite Sundays that we have at Central. It's just so inspiring to me because my life has been completely transformed by Jesus. And so when I see other people that have encountered that same exact transformation, it just like gets me excited. I personally think that there's no better physical demonstration of the gospel than seeing someone being lowered into the waters of baptism, metaphorically representing dying to their old self and then being risen up as a new creation. And in these services, I always find myself doing like the man cry, where I'm like trying to not to cry, but like my face is just like pouring water, but I'm trying to like cover it up and stuff. Because honestly, it's just so inspiring, and it gets me so excited. And maybe that's you. Maybe you've been coming here and you've had that experience where God has come into your life and Jesus has set you on a new path, and everything for you is starting to change, and you've decided to follow Him. Well, baptism is your opportunity, and next week is it. And so you can register for that if you want to be a part of that. You can simply go to Central Connect out in our lobby. Someone will be happy to sign you up there, or you can just send a quick email to baptism@centralcc.ca. And so we're going to continue singing this morning. So if you're able, why don't you stand with me today as we invite the band to sing a couple more songs.
We're heaven-spun creations, His pride and adoration, and treasures woven by His love. His His careful hands, they hold us safe within His promise of calling and of destiny. Where heaven spun creations, His pride and adoration, treasures woven by His love. His careful hands, they hold us safe within His promise of calling and of destiny.
And I will sing of your done, and I will remember how far you carry me from beginning until the end. You are faithful, faithful to the end.
A father's heart that's full.
Beginning
Today we have this really cool opportunity to pause for a moment and to remember, to reflect, to push pause on the chaos of our life and the things that we stress about and worry about and hope for and pray for, and just stop and remember. Today we get an opportunity again to put our faith not in our circumstances, not in our boss, not in our career, not in our family, not in our way of living, not even the very fact that we live in Canada, but we put our faith today in His faithfulness. In His faithfulness. That He said, that He promised He will finish what He started, that He continues to prove Himself over and over again. And even though we doubt and even though we forget, He is faithful. The Bible talks that He was faithful, that He humbled Himself and submitted Himself to death, even death on a cross. He was faithful to the Father so that you and I may stand here today with hope, with forgiveness of sins, with a picture of the future and hope of eternity with Him. And so today we're going to just take a moment. We're going to take communion. And so there's a cup and seat in front of you. It looks like this. And if you're a follower of Christ, I just want you to encourage you to go ahead and grab that. Maybe you're here and you're on a journey with Christ and you haven't maybe fully made that commitment. Today you can make that choice and you can participate with us. And you're more than welcome to do that. But this is something we do as believers, to just remember. See, there's nothing special or holy about the cup. And as Johnny indicated, it's just a juice cup. It's just a little bit of grape juice and a bad, poorly tasting cracker. Nothing fancy about it, but you know what makes it special is that it stops. It forces us to stop and remember. It forces us to reflect on all that He has done, the forgiveness that we received through the shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that because He submitted Himself to death, that He died for our sins, that we may have life, we can stand here today. And so today, can we just take a moment? In the quietness of our heart, can we just close our eyes? In your own way, can you just thank the Lord for His faithfulness? Can you thank the Lord for His forgiveness of sins? And maybe you're here and you say, God, I just need You to forgive me today. I just need You to cover me again with Your grace. I just need You to remind me again how faithful You are in my life and show me in the past how You've always stayed with me and stood with me. God, just show me again. If that's you, just close your eyes in this place and just in the quietness of your heart, just say, thank You, Jesus. As we do that together, let's just take the cup, take the bread rather, the first layer, which represents His body that was bruised and was broken for us. Let's take it and remember. And the cup, which represents His blood that was shed for us, for the forgiveness of sins. Let's take this in remembrance. So Jesus, we just humble ourselves this moment. We just want to say thank You. We remember. We remember. And we're thankful. In Jesus' name we pray. This together. This is really our story, the hope that we have in Him.
Man of sorrows, led by God, by His own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus. Silent. salvation, pray your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Scent of heaven. Debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me, whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt.
Church, let's lift our voice and declare this the truth. That's our story. That's our hope. That's why we sing. So thank you for singing with us today. Let me go ahead and be seated.
Great. How's everybody doing? Good. Great to have you with us today. How many of you are ready for summer? Not very many. Okay. Several of you are. That's great. How many of you would just love the winter to keep going? Okay. That's awesome. Well, we just want you to know we have a lot of churches on the street, and they'd be glad to have you. I'm just joking. We're so glad that you're with us. We don't want you to leave, and you're just welcome. And you're part of the weird family of people who like winter. And so thanks so much for being with us. We are glad for you to be here. If you're with us online, too, thanks so much, wherever you are in the world, and so glad that you could join us. Listen, today I woke up excited to be with you because I believe there's something that God wants to do if you'll open your heart, if you'll believe in faith, that God actually would love to take those of us, all of us, who are often powerless and make us into powerful. This is actually what God does. And so today we're actually in week two of a series we've been in entitled Walking Dead. And we've been talking about how all of us really are alive, but the question we've been posing is, are we really living? Are you really alive? Are you really living this life the way that it was designed to live? If you're like me, sometimes you find yourself going through the motions of life wondering, does this really matter what I'm doing? Does it really matter what I do every single day? The rhythms of my week, does it matter? Pastor Bill had a great message. We talked about that last week. And we're really excited. Next week, we're actually going to be talking about this idea for a lot of us when we have friendship, we have partners, we have those we're in relationships with, but how many of us, we feel like we're all alone. What do you do when you feel like you're surrounded by a sea of people, but you feel like you're all alone? Maybe you're here today and you feel like that. We're going to be talking about that next week. And so today, I want to talk to you about power. I want to talk to you about power. I want to start with a simple question. The question is this, have you ever felt powerless? Have you ever been in a position or a place in life where you felt like you were absolutely powerless? Maybe you had a title, maybe you had a position, and yet regardless of what somebody called you or what your title was, you felt like you couldn't do anything about it. You had no authority. For us, I realize that looks like a lot of things across a lot of arenas in our life. For some of us that are parents, you know what this could feel like. For those of you that you have a title as a mom or as a title as a dad, and yet when your kids make decisions that are different than you would make, or they make decisions that you actually recognize as harmful, what do when you have a position but you're powerless to do anything about it? Or for others of us, we have these titles in our job where we've been given this, you know, position. And yet, what do you do when you have three people who tell you how to do your job, right? Does anyone, you know what I'm talking about, right? You have like, you know, eight bosses and you're like, really? Like, I just need one. Like, I'm good. And what do you do when everyone, you know, has an opinion on how you should do what you do and you feel like no one's really backing you up and you question who you are? And what do you do when you feel powerless? For others of us, we're in relationships and maybe you found yourself or you have found yourself in a relationship that's controlling and it's manipulative and it seems like no matter what you do, it's not enough to change it. You feel powerless or if you've been through a divorce, you know this feeling. You're fighting over things and kids and assets and you can't move forward, you can't move backward. The image is that of like quicksand. It's like the more that you struggle to move forward, the more you struggle back. It's like you're in this sinking pit. And so what do you do when you feel like you're powerless? I want to talk about that. I want to talk about this today because what I believe is that there is a God who is powerful. And the amazing thing about this God is that as we submit ourselves to him, his promise is not to leave us powerless. The truth is all of us have fallen short in our own strength, and yet there's a God who promises if we trust him, if we submit to him, that he has all kinds of strength for us because he is an all-powerful God. And so I want to start today with a story, and it's a story that we read about in one of the accounts of Jesus in the book of Matthew. And so if you have a Bible, you can turn with me. We're going to go there in just a moment, Matthew chapter 8. And I love this story because it's a story about a Roman officer or a Roman centurion. And all that means, if you don't know what a centurion is, it just meant that this officer was one that had esteemed himself or distinguished himself over everybody else. He was over 100 men. And what you need to know is, as those that were in a Roman army, they would find themselves there by a strict sect of rules and regulations. They got there because they were ruthless, to be totally honest. And so you can imagine to be an officer over, a centurion over 100 men meant that you had to be a cut above the rest. This is kind of this person. He's bright, he's intelligent, he's an accomplished guy. The Bible calls him a Gentile, which just simply means that he's someone who didn't follow God. He was someone outside of the Israelite people who followed God, and he was, finds himself in a position where the truth is he was of the least likely to impress Jesus. He's like me, actually, and he's like a lot of you, who has a lot of things that aren't right in him, have a lot of things that have really, truthfully, has no reason to impress Jesus, and yet Jesus is amazed by this person. So we're going to read this story together in Matthew chapter 8, verse 5. And let's read that right now. It says this. It says, when Jesus returned to Capernaum, a Roman officer or a Roman centurion, he came and he pleaded with him. He said, Lord, my young servant, he lies in bed and he's paralyzed and in terrible pain. So Jesus said, well, I'll come and I'll heal him. But the officer said, Lord, I'm not worthy for you to come into my home. So just say the word from where you are and my servant will be healed. I know this because I'm under authority of my superior officers, and I have authority over my soldiers. I only need to say go, and they go, or come, and they come. And if I say to my slaves, do this, they do it. Again, this wasn't a condoning of slavery. It was just, this was the nature of the world in which they lived it. And so it goes on. It says, when Jesus heard this, he was amazed. In fact, turning to those who were following him, he said, I tell you the truth, I haven't seen faith like this in all Israel. Then Jesus said to the Roman officer, he said, go back home because you have believed it has happened. And the young servant was healed that same hour. Now, I think one of the reasons I love this story, I love it for a few reasons, but one of the main ones I think is because I think the centurion is a lot like a lot of you. He's a guy who's done the right things in his headspace to live the life that he thought he could. He did all of the right things that he could to esteem himself over those around him, to distinguish himself around his sphere of influence. He was bright, he was intelligent, he built a good reputation. He was in this esteemed position that he thought would give him the power he needed to live the life that he wanted. And yet, what do you do when you find yourself in a place where everything that you thought you needed to live the life that you wanted wasn't enough? What do you do when the doctor calls and everything that you've worked for to control in your life doesn't mean anything because that diagnosis changes everything? What do you do when you find yourself at work in a place where you've just kind of sort of settled, or maybe you've even given in, you want to call it quits in your relationships, whatever it, what do you do when you feel like you're powerless? This guy is like a lot of us. And I think the truth is, for some of you, maybe even your reality is you find yourself here today because for you, you came to your end. You say, actually, the reason I'm here is because I tried everything else, and this is sort of my last resort. The truth is, if this doesn't work out, I don't know what else is. Because I've tried everything in my own strength, and I've come to my end. And so maybe God can make this better because I certainly can't on my own. This is the thing that we find ourselves in often. Many of us find ourselves at a place, and if we haven't, we likely will at some point. And what I've found, at least if you're like me in my life, my response when I feel powerless is usually one of a few responses. The first one is I give myself a pity party for a couple weeks, and right, I don't know if you're like me, you do that, and you feel bad about yourself, and so you buy yourself some jalapeno kettle-cooked Lay's chips. Sorry, just having a moment there. And you just have, you know, you have a night by yourself, and that family size bag of kettle-cooked chips, right? And you sort of feel bad for yourself for a season until you kind of work yourself out of it and you say, you know what? I'm actually gonna fight for this thing. And so for what, you know, whatever arena that is, maybe it's in your work, you say, I'm just gonna fight for this. I'm gonna fight for this position, and I'm gonna do everything I can. I'm gonna work harder. I'm gonna really press into this thing. I'm gonna say more. I'm gonna do more. Or maybe in your relationships, you're like, you can go negative. You say, I'm gonna fight this relationship. I'm not gonna give in to this thing that this, you know, partner wants from me. I'm going to give them the silent treatment. Or maybe you do the opposite. You're going to do more to sort of, you drum up more strength to do it. Or you say, I'm going to find another doctor who has a better diagnosis. And we say we're going to fight. And if you're like me, you go through this cycle of it a few times before you kind of realize that maybe this isn't going to work. Maybe I was actually kind of naive to think that I could do this. Maybe I was naive to think that I could fight this. And you find yourself in a place a lot of us find ourselves in, which is a response where we just kind of give in. And we sort of settle for what is sort of the mundane. We settle for just kind of living instead of really being alive. And we find ourselves there for a season. And everything, if anything else changes, we sometimes go to the last sort of position, the last response where we say, well, then I just give up. because I don't know how else I'm going to get through this. And so we give up. And the centurion, he really could have done all three of these. And maybe he even did. I don't know. Maybe in his headspace he said, you know what, I'm going to fight for this servant because I love him. And I'm going to find a way to fix, you know, get him, you know, healed or whatever. And so he, you know, made his rounds and he thought he was going to fight for it. And maybe in his own headspace he says, well, maybe I just need to give in. Maybe I just need to accept this for what it is. And the truth is he could have quite easily given up and said, well, I'll just find someone else then and I'll just move on. There was no reason why he was needed to be loyal to this servant. And yet what's amazing about this story, here's the thing I love about it, is he sees an angle that nobody else sees. He sees a fourth angle. And Jesus is blown away because all of the other religious leaders, all of the priests, all of the teachers, all of the so-called devout followers of God, none of them saw this angle. And Jesus is actually amazed by it because this centurion, he sees an angle that nobody else sees. This guy who doesn't even follow God, he sees an angle, and Jesus is, the Bible says he marveled at it. He was amazed by it. And so I guess the question is what did he see? What was it that he understood that for most of us, we don't understand? What was the angle that he had that was different than me and you? And I think the angle sort of comes into this thing that we could call the paradox of power. He understood this idea of the paradox of power. Here, the thing about relationships is interesting. We all have these dynamics, right? For me and my wife, we have this relational dynamic. And the way it works is my wife tells me what to do, and I do it. This is just a powerful dynamic, right? This is the paradox of power. She says, you know, do it. I say, okay, I'll do it. You're wearing the pants. So that's, how, you know, right? Am I right, ladies? No. Okay, that's great. Good job. That was a good response. Okay, the paradox of power, and we experience it, these dynamics. I thought it'd be kind of fun today to sort of have some fun together and illustrate it. So I want to invite up my friend today. You already heard him, Johnny. He's our host. Didn't he do a great job today? Awesome. Come on up, Johnny. John's going to help us, and Johnny's going to be Jesus. Isn't he kind of looks like Jesus, do you think? You grab a seat, Greg. Great. Thanks for being here, man. Johnny's going to be Jesus, and you did a great job today, my friend, by the way. Thanks for being here. And so I thought it'd be kind of fun to illustrate what often happens with many of us. You see, for a lot of us, we are introduced to the person of Jesus, and maybe you're even one of those people. You're here today, and there's aspects of this idea of Jesus and the things that he taught that is actually really intriguing to you and really dynamic. And for you, you go, you know what? I think my life is actually better because of Jesus. And many of you in the room, you've actually made a decision to go, you know, actually, I want Jesus to be the one who's on the seat of control. You know, he's the one who's leading the way. He's the one who's sort of leading my life. And so in a lot of ways, what we do is we kind of put ourselves in a submissive position where we say, you know, I submit my life to you, Jesus. Jesus, thanks, Jesus. You're doing great. I submit my life to you. I want you to be the leader of my life. I want you to bless me. I want you to sort of take my old way and change it and make me new. And we start this life with him. Many of us do this. And we kind of find ourselves going down this journey and we're going through life and we're like, yeah, man, like, wow, life is actually pretty good. Like with Jesus in my life, like things are pretty great. And we're like, thank you, Jesus. Like this is really great. And so we're like, man, Jesus, we're a good team. Hit that. Jesus, come on, Jesus. What? Anyways, we're going through through life with Jesus, and we're like, man, this is actually a lot better. And then all of a sudden, we kind of find ourselves in a place where, you know, our boss calls us into his office, and we start thinking, oh no, like, you know, I heard rumors of downsizing. We're like, Jesus, like, get over here, Jesus, I need you, like, Jesus, help me, like, I can't lose this job, I need it, I need your help. And so we're like, okay, oh, what's that? You want to give me a raise? Oh, okay, now that's a different story. Like, benefits, that's a promotion. I love that. Actually, I find myself in this job, I'm finding purpose, and wow, this is going really good. Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Like, this is great, Jesus. Thanks so much. You're great, Jesus. And so we go through life, and we get to a point where we get, all of a sudden, we have this test done, we get these, you know, this scare of, a diagnosis, and we're like, they get the test results, and we're like, oh, Jesus, like, I need your help, Jesus, like, Jesus, man, what's happening, what did I do to deserve this, and we're waiting on the test results are negative. Well, that's great, I feel good, I feel like, wow, I feel stronger, thank you, Jesus, this is so good. And so we have this dynamic, and things are going really, Jesus, so good, thank you, Jesus. And we get to this place where, you know, one day we wake up and we're like, man, I'm just kind of lonely. Like, I'd love like to settle down and find a wife or something. And so, Jesus, if you could just help me find, hold on, before you help me though, let me pick her out. And so we kind of scan the room. We say, I'll take that one. Honey Boo Boo, you can come on over here. Honey Boo Boo. And I don't know why I picked that name. It sounds like a great name. So we say, Jesus, would you just bless Honey Boo Boo and me? And would you make our relationship great? And would you go before us? And would you give us like perfect kids? And God, thank you so much. Jesus, this is great. Like I got this relationship and it's good. And Jesus, come back. Honey Boo Boo's crazy. She's crazy, Jesus. Get her away from me, Jesus. Get Honey Boo Boo away. And do you see what we do? This is kind of what we do with Jesus. And sorry, Honey Boo Boo, if you're here, that's a great name. We're going to find you someone after the service. You can report to the Central Connect in the lobby. And so we have this dynamic with Jesus where it's like this paradox of power where we go, yeah, I realize that every time I need you, you're in my life, but then all of a sudden I assume control. Now, I realize for a lot of you, you're way more mature than me in the room, and that's probably good because we need you because I certainly am not. And so for you, you'd say, I would actually never do that. For me, I would never let Jesus off the seat of control. But for you, it looks a little different. For you, it's more like you just kind of like, you're like one cheek in it with Jesus. And so it's kind of like this awkward thing where you're like just trying to make it work. And it's like a bad Instagram waiting to happen. This is what it looks like right here, Jesus. Somebody better Snapchat that. There we go. And we wonder why we face these dynamics of feeling weak because we actually are sharing the control with Jesus. Others of us, we sort of write the script out and we just want Jesus to sign off on it, right? We sort of have it all figured out. We say, I want to live a life of generosity. And we're like, Jesus, you love generosity. You gave away all those fish. Like, we sign off on that. And we're like, Jesus, like, I love some wine in my life. We live in wine country. And Jesus, you love wine. You turn water into wine. Like, so you sign off on that, Jesus. And I love to marry a virgin. And maybe my kids, they could grow up and be virgins too. Jesus, you love virgins too. Your mama was a virgin. So you go on and you're like, some of you, just think about that for a moment. And you're like, just sign off, Jesus. And you see the problem with this is that Jesus didn't come this Easter. He didn't come 2,000 years ago to just simply make things a little bit better, to just partner with us, although he does do that. He actually came to take those of us, all of us who are weak and broken, and actually transform us into something that's beautiful, that's powerful, that's actually made for dominion on this earth, to not just live, but to thrive. This is what Jesus really came to do. And yet it doesn't work unless he's in that seat. It doesn't work. Can you thank Johnny? Thanks so much, man. You did a great job. That was great and somewhat awkward. That's awesome. And so we have this paradox of power, and I think it looks like a few things. I think what it looks like for a lot of us is that we believe, we may not admit it out loud, but we believe intuitively that we think that the more title we have, the more money we have, the more position we have, and the authority that we acquire or achieve, that ultimately the more power we get, that the happier we'll be. And yet for a lot of us, for all of us, the opposite is true. The more that we submit our power to those that are above us and ultimately to God, the more authority and the more power we actually have. See, this is the paradox of power. It's all about understanding this word that most of us don't like. It's this word authority. And if you're like me, you want to be the one who's in control. You're the one who wants to be in authority. And yet the opposite is true. Power is found in submission. And so here we read in verse 8, this officer, he says this. He says, Lord, I'm not worthy to have you come into my home. And again, whenever I read the Bible, I look for these key words that kind of pop out at me. It's just what I do, and it helps me. And it says this. He says, just say the word. Just say the word. These two words popped out at me, say and word. Just say the word from where you are, and my servant will be healed. I got looking into these words, and it's fascinating because this word speak or this word say, it actually means to lay to rest. It means to bring this message to a closure. It's like the proverbial mic drop. Jesus drops it, and it's like it is finished. Jesus speaks, and it happens. Jesus speaks, and things that are dead come alive. Jesus speaks, and things that are broken are made whole. This is what happens. There's nothing left to say. This is what happens when God speaks. There's nothing, and then there's something. It's this powerful dynamic, a God who speaks and literally everything changes. And then I got looking at this word means expressing the thoughts of the Father. And maybe you think, well, why does that really matter? Well, it matters because this centurion, he realizes that Jesus is actually tapped into something that's far greater than even him. This is the powerful thing, that Jesus is actually tapped into his Father's will. He's tapped into the power of his Father. This is the paradox of power. And what it does is it tricks us sometimes into believing that the power we have is from us. That we, if you're like me, you begin to believe over time that the successes that you have are as a result of you. You begin to believe over time that the stuff that you have and the achievements that you have and the title that you have and the position that you have is because of you. And actually, there could be nothing further from the truth. The Bible even speaks to this idea that every good and perfect gift, it comes from the Father. It comes from God. And so it's this idea that all of us, our power doesn't come from us, it comes from God. And so the question, I guess, for us is, whose power are you walking in? Whose power are you walking in? Are you walking in your own strength, which often leads to weakness? Or are you walking in his strength? Are you walking in a power that's bigger than you? And I think the reason the centurion knows that Jesus is tapped into something beyond himself is because he's in the exact same position. He totally gets this. This is his world. This is everything that he does. This is where it gets really fascinating. Look at this with me, verse 9. It says, I know this, I understand this, Jesus, because I am under, that's an important word, I'm under the authority of my superior officers, and as a result, I have authority over my soldiers. I only need to say go, and they go, or come, and they come. And if I say to my slaves, do this, they do it. Here's what's fascinating to me. This Roman officer, he understands this idea, this under-over principle, we could call it today. He realizes that his power or his authority over is actually directly proportional to his submission under. That the only reason he has power is because he's submitted under. Actually, what's fascinating is when he would speak, people would literally, well, they wouldn't literally, but they would hear the voice of Caesar. He would speak with the authority of his ruling officer, Caesar. He would speak with it. Why was that? Was it because of his accolades? Was it because of all the things that he had done? Was it because of how esteemed he was over everybody else? No. It was 100% because of his submission to Caesar, to Rome. What Rome needed, which is what gave him his voice. That the powerful truth is that it was only in the coming under did he receive the power over. And so this is where I really got thinking on this. This is this paradox of power, that the only way that you actually become influential, the only way that you become strong in your voice, the only way that you become distinguished in your world, that you have a voice in your relationships, that you become impactful, is actually by giving or submitting your life to something bigger than you, to those above you, and ultimately to God over you. And what's amazing is Jesus comes, and even God in flesh, Jesus amongst us, he comes and he demonstrates this exact same thing. We read about it here in Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Look at this with me. It says that you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, he came under, and he took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. Now look what happens. This is amazing. It says, therefore, look what God does. God elevated him to the place of highest honor, and he gave him the name that's above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee would bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord. And what's amazing to me is that I think for so many of us, the reason that we have so little authority, that we have so little of a voice in our world, our sphere of influence, that we have so little strength, is that we've actually missed, we've forgotten where our strength comes from, that it doesn't come from us. I love how the psalmist even says, he says, I lift my eyes up to the mountains. Where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth. That we recognize our strength isn't from us, it's actually from God. And what's actually really fascinating about this is where this gets me excited, because to me it's just another proof of who God is and how his principles are true, is that even if you don't follow God, if you begin to try this out, this idea, this paradox of power, if you try this submission idea out, it actually works even if you don't follow Jesus. So I encourage you to try it because Jesus teaches it and it's just a truth to who he is. You begin to try it in your relationship with your spouse or your friendships. And I think what you'll see is that actually the more that you submit your voice and your power to that other person, the more voice and the more power and influence you actually have in that relationship. It's actually a powerful principle. Even in your work, the same is true. That the more that you submit yourself to those that are above you, the more that you actually submit yourself to those that you answer to, instead of doing end runs, instead of trying to fight for position, instead of trying to get people to notice you and to cut others down, the more that you submit to those above you, the louder the voice that you actually have, the more influence that you actually have. Same thing is actually true with your kids. We think that sometimes we want our kids to just, you know, submit, like, you know, go to your room for a week, like, go for a year. I don't know what it is for you, right? We're just like, you know, we want to sort of assert our dominance in some ways, and yet I remember growing up and I had this decision to make I was asking my dad rather if I could do this one thing, and I couldn't even tell you what it was. And I just remember him, he did this a lot. He'd say, well, he said, I trust you, you'll make the right decision. I was like, oh, dad, like, you're the worst. Like, just say no so I can be mad at you, right? Just say no and then I can be, you know, upset with you. And then I was like, okay, I guess I can't do that because it isn't the right thing to do. And there's something about that. You submit your power to someone and you actually have a louder voice. You submit yourself to those above you and ultimately to God, and God lifts you up. Let me ask you today, have you submitted your power, your authority, your voice, your strength to God? Have you submitted your voice to him? Have you submitted your strength to him, recognizing that this is the way to true strength, that this is the way to true power? Story ends this way, and I love it. It says in verse 10, it says, when Jesus heard this, he was amazed. It's amazing because there's only two times that Jesus was ever amazed. There was this story, and then there was one when he went to his hometown, and no one believed in him, and so they couldn't do any miracles. This is one of the two. It says that he was amazed. Turning to those who were following him, he said, I tell you the truth, I haven't seen faith like this in all of Israel. I got thinking this week, what does that even mean? What does that even mean? He was amazed by their faith. Like, what is that actually, what is that even talking about? I don't even quite comprehend that. So we started just processing it. And what's interesting, I think, for a lot of us in our context, that we associate faith and belief very similarly. We say, you know, I believe in God, or I don't believe in God. I believe in a Christian faith, or I have a faith, or whatever. We sort of associate it with something that we think. And yet the Bible sort of calls out this idea. It says, well, listen, like, even the demons believe in God and they shudder. Even even Satan believes in God. So we believe there's an enemy who actually believes in God as well. And there's this distinguishing factor to faith. And I think what you need to know, what's different about it, is that the Bible speaks to faith differently than we think about it. If you're like me, what you do is you try to conjure up more faith. You say, listen, I'm gonna have more faith to believe for something better. I'm gonna have faith to believe that God is gonna, you know, he's gonna carry me through this. I'm gonna just do more. I'm gonna conjure up more faith to believe for this diagnosis or for this disease or this situation. And what's interesting is that faith doesn't come from us. Let me read this to you for a moment. Ephesians 2, verse 8 says, for it's by grace that you've been saved through faith. And this is not of any of your own doing. It's actually the gift of God. It's not the result of your works, so that no one would boast. You see, the point is that we have nothing that we do in our own strength that moves us from being powerless to powerful. There's nothing we could do. That this gift of faith is not something that we conjure up in our own. This idea of trying to move from powerless to powerful isn't something we just say, I'm just going to have more faith. It's actually in the submitting under to God that he gives us more faith to believe for more over. It's this dynamic, this paradox of power. It doesn't make sense, and yet the more that you submit to this Jesus, the more that you submit to this God, the more that you know his strength. And today, I don't know where you find yourself at, why you've even come today, but can I just tell you, if you've come into this place tired, if you've come into this place weary, if you're just wanting to, if you've just given in to your situation and your circumstance, you've given in your relationship, maybe you've even given up, maybe in your job or your relationship with your kids or your diagnosis, whatever it is, you've come in feeling like you're powerless, can I just ask you today, would you consider submitting to someone who's so much bigger than you, who's so much stronger than you, who's got it figured out way beyond anything you could figure out in your own imagination, who's got plans for you, not to harm you, to prosper you, that his plans are simply that if you would submit to him, if you would come under, that you would have so much more power over, that you're not stuck, that you're not lost, that you're not broken, that God is not done with you, that if you'd simply submit to him, there's all kinds of strength for you. This is the power of what Jesus did. This is the power of a God who comes and he takes things that are broken like me and you, who are powerless, who are stuck, who often ride on empty, who are just existing. And he says, the more that you submit to me, the more that I want to change you, the more I want to transform you, the more I want to give you a voice that sounds like mine so you'd have influence and you would impact people all across this region. He says, if you just trust me, I want to change you from the inside out. And so if you're here today and you just need God's strength, you need God to do something, because if you're honest, you've been alive, but you haven't been really living. If you're in that place today, I want to just invite you in this moment, just to every eye closed, every head bowed around this room. I want to invite you in this moment just to simply raise your hand if you're here and you say, God, I just need your strength. God, I need your strength. All across this room, my hands are going up. People that just say, God, I need your strength. God, I need you to take me from being powerless to being powerful. I need you to change me from the inside, and I submit to you. If that's you, just raise up your hand. We just want to pray for you. That's great. Amazing. Let's pray together. God, I thank you for this family today. God, people all across this room, and myself included, God, who recognize that it's actually in our weakness that we are strong, that it's only through our weakness that we can know your strength. And God, today we come before you recognizing we need you. God, for many in the room who maybe are in a fight, God, they've been fighting for all of these things and they're exhausted and they're tired and they feel like they're, is it even worth fighting for? God, these relationships, these positions, these titles. God, for those that have given in and are just existing, God, who are going through the motions, maybe they've even been coming to church for months and weeks, and it just feels like they're powerless to do anything about it. They've just sort of given in. They've settled for something less than what you've created them for. God, I pray that we would see things like this centurion. We would see this fourth angle, God, where we would simply recognize that our power, that our authority, it comes from you, and it comes in direct proportion to how submitted we are to you. So God, I guess in this moment, we just are really saying we submit to you. We recognize that we need you, God, that our life is not worth nearly what it would be, God, without you. And so, God, we invite you and we submit our hearts to you. We ask you to take these broken vessels, God, these vessels that often miss the mark, that are lacking, and would you turn them into something that's beautiful, something that's strong and full of your power, from powerless to powerful. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I want to encourage you today, for those of you that are here that made a decision to follow Jesus or to take a step towards him, can I encourage you to tell someone, to fill out a connection card? We want to journey with you. And we also want to bless you today. One of the things we love at Central, before you go, is we love to bless you with words, because there's power in words. And so if you've come in empty today, my hope for you, God's hope for you, is that you would leave full. If you've come in broken, that he would begin the process of mending you. It doesn't always happen overnight, but if you trust him, that you submit to him, he wants to give you faith to believe for something better. And that the closer you walk with him, he wants to take you from being powerless to powerful. You're loved. Hope you have an amazing week. Don't forget, as you go, to take your communion cups with you. And if you need prayer, we do have a prayer team that's going to be here as well. Have a great week.